Hello and welcome back to Chemistea Time. Last lesson, we were introduced to VSEPR and electron geometries. In this lesson, we will be taking a more in-depth look at some of the structures you may encounter. We already know that the shape of a molecule is determined by the number of electron groups around the central atom. However, not all electron groups have the same effect. Let's look at three examples, CH4, NH3, and H2O. When we draw the Lewis structures for these molecules, we can see they are very similar and they all have four electron groups. The major difference is that in NH3, we have a lone pair instead of a fourth hydrogen. In H2O, we have two lone pairs. However, when we look at the bond angles around the central atom, CH4 is about 109.5 degrees, while NH3 is about 107 degrees, and H2O is about 104.5 degrees. So we know that the lone pairs are decreasing the bond angles and pushing the other hydrogens closer together. But why does this happen? Well, remember that electrons are negative, so they repel each other. As a result, the lone pairs take up more space than other bonded atoms because the electrons are trying to stay as far away from one another as possible. This effect increases as we replace more bonding pairs with lone pairs, which is why water has an even lower bond angle. Also, electrons in a bonding pair share the attractive force between two nuclei, while lone pairs are only attracted to one nucleus. The presence of lone pairs also creates a need to distinguish electronic geometry from molecular geometry. Up until now, we have only been using electron geometry to describe molecules, which takes into account all electron groups. Molecular geometry is different in that it describes molecules based on the shape of only the bonds around the central atom, while still taking into account the effects of lone pairs. We know that a molecule with four electron groups has a tetrahedral electron geometry. Now, if we only consider the bonds around the central atom, we need to consider what those groups are. If we have four bonds and no lone pairs, it still has a tetrahedral molecular geometry. However, if we replace one bond with a lone pair, we have a different molecular geometry since now we have three bonds. This molecular geometry is known as trigonal pyramidal. As we continue to replace bonds with lone pairs, our molecular geometry will continue to change. It is important to keep in mind that replacing bonds with lone pairs changes molecular geometry, but not electron geometry, because the number of electron groups is still the same. Because of this, you will also need to determine electron geometry before you can determine molecular geometry. A molecule with four electron groups can be tetrahedral, trigonal pyramidal, or bent, depending on the number of lone pairs. A molecule with five electron groups can have a trigonal bipyramidal, seesaw, T-shaped, or linear molecular geometry, depending on the number of lone pairs. However, it is important to note that the placement of electrons is important in order to minimize electron-electron repulsion. Remember, with a trigonal bipyramidal geometry, you have both axial and equatorial positions. By placing electrons on the equatorial position, you reduce the electron-electron repulsion. This is why we end up with a seesaw, T-shaped, and linear geometries. Finally, a molecule with six electron groups can have an octahedral, square pyramidal, or square planar molecular geometry, depending on the number of lone pairs. Again, we need to remember to minimize electron-electron repulsion, so lone pairs are placed on opposite sides instead of adjacent ones. When we start to look at some more complex molecules, we will often run into situations where we have several interior atoms. For these types of molecules, we can treat each interior atom as an independent central atom and determine the molecular geometry of each. Let's look at glycine, shown here. When we look at glycine, we see there are four interior atoms that make up its structure: nitrogen, carbon, another carbon, and oxygen. Now let's try to determine the molecular geometry for each from left to right, starting with nitrogen. The nitrogen has four electron groups, which tells us it has a tetrahedral electron geometry. These electron groups consist of three bonds and one lone pair, which means it has a trigonal pyramidal molecular geometry. Now we can do this for every interior atom in glycine. The first carbon will have a tetrahedral electron and molecular geometry. The second carbon will have a trigonal planar electron and molecular geometry. And the oxygen on the end will have a tetrahedral electron geometry and a bent molecular geometry. Well, I hope you all enjoyed today's lesson on molecular geometries. Join us next time when we discuss intermolecular forces. Until then, have a wonderful day. Thank you.